to Memphis. That's how I got to Memphis. If you need somebody enough, you go where your heart wants to go. That's how I got to Memphis. That's how I got to Memphis. I know if you've seen her, you tell me, 'cause you are my friend. I've got to find her and find out the trouble she's in.
By Sunday, somebody's face was on me, passed out cold on the concrete. Love sure is a bitch when you liver scorch. South in Dirty County at a whole nother bar at a band play. Since it wasn't verified, more strange wind, even more smoke, and filled by a legendary live oak.
Just like hanging out. And so this next song that's on Exodus record is based on conversations in the car to and from the methadone clinic in South Georgia. In 1996 with an accounting degree from Georgia Southern University, and see how that worked out. But I pretty quickly got a little deal to write songs, and our music growing, and I got some big record deals, and they had a lot of ideas for me. Like that I could wear like ball gowns and sing about breathing, because they had this artist, Faith Hill, was doing really good with that. And you know, I wanted to think about doing something like that. And I was writing all these quirky, kind of weird country songs and walking around in weird clothes, holding like an old satanic guitar that wouldn't stay in tune, and singing songs about fucking Satan and stuff like that. So it was this really strange kind of misfit. So I finally weaseled my way out of that, and I was working at a fancy lady's shoe store in Nashville, and I wrote this song, and Miss Nancy Griffith heard it, a great Texas singer. Because I don't know if it was a good move or not, but I decided I would try and write an answer song to Jesus the Missing Years about what Jesus' mother, Mary, was doing during those years. I don't feel like Mary gets a lot of airtime in the Bible. I'm just trying to throw a little ink her way. So this is... It was hot, 100 in the shade, when Mary got a note from this guy named Gabe. She don't remember getting pregnant, but she did. By all accounts, she turned out one heck of a kid. But walking home from church one day, he just up and disappeared. Maybe he went to find Santa, or maybe he went to get him. He was just 12 years old, this miracle she carried. It was all so confusing, she wasn't even married. So she fled south to Elizabeth, her eldest cousin, who despite her old age also had one. And in a duplex with a busted cement gnome, well, Chattanooga was as good as home. And you know, that's in Tennessee. There's Barbie lovers and firecrackers and train trackers and Coca-Cola makers and insurance takers. And a lot of hot preachers. They almost booked a beach trip, but they didn't have a word. They paid biscuits in daylight for whoever might stop by, but they didn't get along in the corner do or die. Well, sweet tea was flowing and so were the tears. Mary lived out her submissive years. Not really free and sure not a boss. Just mostly lonely and mostly lost. Wherever Jesus was and whatever God had in mind, she hoped her boy was out there somewhere having a good time. cause chance just seems to follow the sky, as if you're walking with a straw. Lots of letters from Mama came full of worry and I told you. She curled up on the couch and watched still that moment. She baked a cake and baked a ham. She opened an account on Instagram. Cause that's what you did, babe. Well, Mary was a good old gal. You know, she didn't stir this shit. She wrote her lines out one at a time, and she didn't complain one bit. She saw Sinead open for Loretta on a Saturday night, like every good virgin does. But she spent most of her time just sitting around and wondering, where in the hell Jesus was. Almost booked a beach trip, but didn't have a way. They baked biscuits at daylight for whoever might stop by, but they didn't get a lot of corn do. Well, time went by like molasses. But it seemed there were no real answers. Just a lot of fast food and raunchy dancing. And things everywhere were the worst kind of wild. She knew in her gut they were coming for her child. With bumpers and thumpers and guns of blaze. Old Jesus was in for some gnarly hazing. Frat boy hazing, that is the worst kind. She thought, oh my God, what happened? He's a bottle of milk and I live inside of his mind. They're gonna kill my mom. They don't like me. So she cut off all her hair. She thought she might could just get there. They would mistake her for a man. It looked kind of mod. It probably wouldn't please God, but she had to have some kind of plan. It turns out there are no fish at the end of a lightning rod. The worst thing you can grow up to be is the sun god. But I'm not sure there's anything anybody can do when people are kidding even when there's nothing wrong with them. So come and gather around me, friend, all my contemporary viewers. And I'll tell you all the story of Mary, the submissive.
Which is kind of a longer story, but the verse is, I was just collecting things. Some of you people that are closer to my age, I'm class of 85, like you might remember this stuff. There's things from our day that are just gone now. And anyway, I had this list of them going in my head. And one day when I needed a song, kind of, and I had that list, and then I made this up. I'll see what you think. Story that I feel like for some reason telling you that I'm in this group called the Hardworking Americans. We're a jam group. That means our songs go on really long time. And also I live in Nashville. And this is, I swear this is gonna sound like bullshit, and sometimes I do, but this is true. I got to make up some songs with Loretta Lynn, a bunch of ones. And she's a cool chick that she parties, man. She's a lot of fun and funny and anyway, when she recorded the songs, she recorded them at this place called the Cash Cabin. She said that I could go be there. And the Cash Cabin is behind old Johnny Cash's house out there. And it's where he died. He recorded all his last records out there. And this cabin was like his man cave. It's a studio now. And Loretta's the only person using it. His son lives out there in that house. And runs that studio and only what really produces her there. And so after I went there, I had these dreams of waking up on the floor there when Johnny Cash would kick me and wake me up, and then I'd wake up in the dream, and then I'd wake up. I had like three of these. And then the fourth one, he kicks me and I look up, and he points over in the corner and says, "You're missing it." And then I wake up, and that's it. So I tell our band leader, who's named Dave Schools, I tell him about this, and he, mostly guys like us, all we care about is songs. Everything seems like it might be a new song. So he calls John Carter and says, "Can we spend the night out there?" You know. And so our whole band went out there. And then Dave held up this bottle of water that had a tube sock on it. And he said, "This is the sock water." And we're a jam band. That means he put some LSD in that one. And then you'd been warned, you know. So we're a jam band. We all drank out of that fucker really quickly. And we started playing our guitars and jamming around and waiting to see what was there. And it's true, Dave said, "Okay, let's do a song." And he looked at me and I was like, I don't just have a song, man, you know. And just B-double-E-double-R, that didn't come right out of my mouth. That was B-double-E at first for a long time. And I was like, "And the R's, like a double of R's." But, you know, songs, man, they take a minute. And he was like, "Nah, come on, just go out in the woods, bro." And so, honest to God, I'm out there in the woods behind that cabin, walking around, 51 years old, tripping balls, looking for a song in the woods. There is no mother that lays awake at night hoping that's what becomes of her. This is a true story, though, and it could be helpful to some of you, especially some of you young people. So I'll tell it.
Not so young.
We were playing in Santa Cruz, California, and there was a guy dressed up as Uncle Sam in the front row, and he was holding up what I clearly could tell was a vial of liquid LSD. I don't know if you've ever seen one of those, but you can tell what they are. And so I kind of walked over to him, and I took it from him, And then I turned around to our drummer and I was like, ah, and I took it to the other and I put the rest in my pocket, right? And this is true. And if about a half hour later, right, I was tripping balls on our light show. We don't even have a light show, man. And I was jamming out, because I'm in a jam band and I don't play the guitar, so I just mostly just have to do this, you know. And I was having a great time, and I thought I sounded terrific. Nobody complained. Everybody seemed to have a good time. So, but then the next night, right, we go down to Los Angeles, and we were supposed to play at the House of Blues, and we were staying in a hotel right across from there. And we, and then, like, we don't, hadn't showered in a while, and so I thought, fuck, I best should do that, you know, because it's, I go to, and I find the rest of that vial in my shirt, and what's the phrase, if something's good, more is better, right? So, boom, I was like, I did the rest, and jumped in the shower, and then, I don't know how long I was in there, because I must have stayed in there long enough for it to work, and maybe it was like hot water or whatever, but then when I went to get out, the door moved, right, so to the right, so I couldn't get out. Fucking door! And I don't know if you ever took a bunch of LSD, but it makes it so stuff like that happens, but it doesn't make you mad. You're like, ah! So I'm like walking around the shower going, this door is jacked. Then I finally get out of the shower, and I get dressed for the gig, and I go to leave my room, same fucking thing. And I'm like, oh, it's gonna be door night, you know, I'm like, here we go. So, again, it takes me like 10 minutes of like chasing this door. I'm laughing about it, I'm sweating again already. I probably had, my eyes were pretty pumpkined, and I get out of my room, and I get down into the lobby, and I go to leave the building, same fucking issue. So I'm moving with the door, and the doorman, right? I'd never thought of that title as linear as I considered it that night. And I was like, man, you gotta get me out of here, man. So the next thing I know, I'm standing on the sidewalk, and I can see the fucking House of Blues. That's where I have to go to sing with my group. I don't know how I didn't end up going over there, man. I didn't go over there. I don't know how I ended up pretty, not that far away, but far enough away to not remember where I was or what I was trying to remember. And I was just walking around Hollywood and having fun, but knew I was missing something. Or that I was supposed to be doing something. And I've had this motto my whole life, it's helped me my whole life, which is this: when in doubt, give up. That's my I use it in doubt. So I see these two fucking guys sitting by a liquor store, you know how guys live? So I sit next to them, and they didn't mind, and the cars are going by, and people are going by, tourists and shit are going by. And then I see this young couple coming up the street, and they're like, they're staring at me, so I'm staring at them. And when they get close, the girl says, aren't you Todd Snyder? And I said, yeah, but where though, you know? And I was so relieved, I remember going, oh, thank God. Ah. And she looked at me funny, because like, but where is a funny question to ask. And I was like, but yeah, she said, my boyfriend and I were going to see your band play. And I was like, you gotta take me with you to that thing. This is true, we get to the, here comes the helpful part, right? So we get to the show and I see the band and I'm like, we can't do this, you guys. And I've gone too far. I can't do the songs, there's no way. And the band was like, that's not how it works in general. We're doing this. And so I didn't know how I was supposed to fucking get through it. I'm like, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Here's the help, our piano player, Chad Staley, he said that a banana helps. That's the helpful part of the story. Is that if you take too much acid, a banana helps. Now, I didn't buy it at first, and then he went in and got one, handed it to me, and fuck if I knew it worked. If you can go on your computer and see the show is on there, we rip it down. We were terrific. I held that banana the whole fucking time too. We're in a jam like that thing. And then, I should add, before I play the song, that after Chad had said, if I had eaten the banana, it would have helped even more than it did. So it's something to consider, you know, if you're ever in that spot. Christian, right-wing Republican, straight white American male, soul-saving flag waving, rush-loving land paving, regional leaders of sales, shirt-tucking, frat house and kick-tapping, back-slapping hater of hippies like me, tree-hugging, peace-loving, pot-smoking, porn-watching, lazy ass hippies like me.
Singing it makes me feel like it's still around. That's my favorite thing about having songs about people that are gone. It feels like when you sing them, they're around. So I'll try to play some Waylon Kickass lead.
Did you hear the devil laughing from the ambulance passing? Or was that just my troubled mind? And don't you want to shake the ground and tear heaven down? Raise your fist to the guilty sky. Sometimes love is a losing fight. You try to keep going, but the ride won't stay. You try to get high, but your heart's too heavy. You got one thing on your mind. Now there's snake eyes on the sidewalk and fireworks overhead. Won't you roll out that red carpet when we all wind up dead? The smoke rings fade like a memory. You're honest as a ghost, baby, twice as free. And you've got faith enough to live this curse. Oh, what if faith is just a false God's verse? You try to keep going, but the ride won't steady. You try to get high, but your heart's too heavy. You got one thing on your mind. It smells like sadness and fell out from your eye. You asked the good Lord why. I didn't care where, I just needed a ride. You know I'm a fool, but even I can see. I guess I got a taste for poison. I've given up on ever being well, and and I keep mine in the horizon. Digging for lies I've yet to tell. And I wish you would heed, but softly say my name. Calm down all the chemicals tearing through my brain. I don't think I've missed you this much since I was 17. I call you in the morning, but I think this is a dream. Cherokee. And I've been staying up all night. I don't give a damn to sleep anymore. My eyelids are heavy, but my dreams don't sing like before. And I apologize a thousand times for holding up the show. I always have the words, but they don't quite know where to go. You said give me one good reason, now I give you 20 more. But don't give yourself away, settle someone else's score.
Chris, thank you for asking. We were up here doing Lazy Sunday, the Chronic What Culls of Narnia, famous for YouTube.
Love that song. So good.
And then I got to that line about Hamilton, and then that music started playing, and I just started singing. It was all very organic.
Yeah, you know what? I was actually backstage, and I was wearing this dress, and then I heard you start to sing so beautifully, I thought, I should get out there. So, here I am.
Why were you wearing the dress?
Okay.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Sorry, guys.
I didn't mean it like
that. Sorry.
Fuck!
okay.
We invited him, so sorry.
What did you say?
It's 2019, Chris.
Wow. Get your boy. The Rick and Morty Money Change Team, dude. Unreal. God.
Sorry.
Are my ears lying to my brain? What in the hell, Chris? You were the only one who was breaking cowbell, man.
Fucking Parnell.
How far you fallen? Oh, piece of shit.
We just get back to the
Chris
song.
Parnell. Sure.
Well, good luck on the road. Treasures untold, how many wonders can one cavern hold? And it's really special the way you do it and the way you do all the things you do with it.
Well, I try to bring a little heart to the song. It's a heartless little tune that I can do. It's called "You're a Red Wagon."
Rocking man, burning as a fuse of Is he found? Is he my trouble? Is he alone? Is no longer? Is I know?
Please pick up the new album, The Valley, at the merchandise table. And for the first time in over a year, I finally got another pressing of a record I put out in 2017 called Lil GL's Honky Tonk Jubilee. And here's one of the favorite songs off that record. Right now, it's the Jamestown Ferry. We hope you like it.
She just caught the Jamestown Ferry. It's not a hot day, January, like she said it'd be. If she ever let me, a face of gold is all she carries. And she got on the Jamestown Ferry, and she said that gold is all she'd ever be. I didn't think that she'd leave me after saying how much she needed me. But the fact still remains, set me all alone, missing the loving of my baby. Lord, it's about to drive me crazy. She was the sweetest piece of ever I've ever known.
But I ain't gonna tell you what I plan to do with it. I don't need the money myself. The people that paid for all them records do. The first one we're doing for you fine folks, this one's called Banjo Picking Man.
Sweet trouble, heartache, my friend. It's gambling time again. Sweet trouble, heartache, my friend. It's gambling time again. Woo!
Thank y'all so much for letting me do my thing up here. Hasta la vista.
I've been wrong to try to come carry totem pole. Primitive, what kind of rig that's ever been made? Driven the back road so it wouldn't get way. If you give me a weed, white, stand white, and you show me a sign.
Dennis Quaid mouths all the words, and it's Jerry Lee's voice, which I think would be very strange. But there's this funny thing that Jerry Lee Lewis does, and I would argue that almost all of his recordings he does this, where it's like this old blues thing or something, where he inserts his name into every song. It's like, just in case you forgot it was him, you know. It's like rappers do that too, you know, like it's like you insert your name into the song and say, this is me. But like Jerry Lee, he's been doing that since the 50s. And so like this song is called Lucky Old Son. And the lyrics are, good Lord above, can you hear me pining? Tears are rolling down my eyes. And Jerry Lee goes, a good Lord above, can you hear me pining? Tears are rolling down a Jerry's eyes. And then every time he says his name, he goes like this. Which is great, you know? That's just what I like about him, he's insane. What's up in the morning? A doubt on the job. Work like the devil for my pay. While the lucky old son ain't got nothing to do except roll around to heaven all day.
I've got three good reasons for leaving Tulsa. Now three good reasons, not just one or two. I've got three good reasons for leaving Tulsa. It's July, August, and you all jump.
Alone. never seen stars before. I could not get across.